Hello guys and welcome back to my channel Technical Interview. And today in this video tutorial series, we're gonna discuss one of the most important concept that you need to understand as a software developer, and that is the design pattern in Java. So the design pattern in Java is equally important for the freshers as well as for the experienced candidate. Just the way the system designing for the distributed system is important for the experienced candidate, similarly, the design pattern for Java is equally important for the freshers during interview. So today in this video, we will be discussing the first concept of the design pattern, and that is the factory design pattern. So let's start with today's video of understanding the first design pattern, and that is the factory design pattern. So before going into the deep dive analysis of what is a factory pattern and why we need a factory pattern, let's first understand the real implementation so that it will be easy for you to visualize the concept. So you must be wondering why in the middle of the tutorial I'm just playing this game, which is called the Atari Breakout game. So Atari Breakout game was one of the popular game in the late 70s. And to understand this factory design pattern, you first have to understand the working principle of this Atari Breakout game. Because if you try to understand this game, it will be completely easy for you to understand that why we need a factory pattern in Java and what are the real-time use cases of the factory pattern. So over here you can see that all the boxes that we are breaking over here are more or less similar. The only thing that differ in each and every boxes is the color and the point that we are achieving on breaking those boxes. So depending on the color code of the box, we are getting points such as 2, 4 or 6. So if you take this concept, this is actually the concept of factory setting, where we have a prototype called as box, and depending on the implementation of the box, we are changing its attribute accordingly. So over here, if you see, the boxes will be our parent class, which gives a prototype or the blueprint of the object. And all these color box are the subclass of our parent component, that is the box class. And depending on the internal implementation of each color box, we are providing the score or the speed of this game. So this is the basic concept of the factory setting. So let's go into the deep dive analysis of how to implement a factory pattern, and let's discuss in detail that what is a factory pattern, what is the use case of the factory pattern, and why we need a factory pattern in our real life scenario. So let's start with the video of understanding in detail that why we need a factory pattern while designing a software for our real life. And always do remember that whenever you are studying a design pattern, always try to relate it with some real-time example so that it will be easy for you to explain it to the interviewer. So that it will be easy for the interviewer to judge you, because that will differentiate you with the other candidates. Because over there, if you are explaining a design pattern based on an example, he will clearly understand that you have not studied it from a book, rather you have implemented that concept in the real-time scenario. So obviously, you will get some added benefit over there, and the chance for you of getting selected will obviously increase. So over here in the comment box also, try to give me some example of some of the application which follows the implementation of the factory pattern. So let's deep dive into this video, and let's understand that why I have given the example of the Atari breakdown over here as the real-time example for the factory design pattern. So over here, if you notice in this game, while developing the game, at that time, each and every component of this game is basically a box. So over here you can see there are plenty of boxes, those are arranged randomly with different colors. Some are marked as blue, green, red or yellow, and each and every color over here have a separate scoring. For example, the blue scores 2 points, the green scores 4 points and so on. So over here among all the different boxes, if you try to find out the similarity among this box, you can see that the two main similarity among all these box is each and every cubes over here is a type box, and number two, each and every glass cubes that we are breaking by the balls have a score associated with it, which means that if we take the box as a parent component, that is a parent class with two properties, that is the color and the point, we can implement that parent box component into different color box, such as red box, green box or the blue box. And internally for each and every boxes, we can specify some unique properties that are associated for each box. And one more behavior you have to notice over here, that all the pokes are getting generated quite randomly. So over here, while designing the game on each and every level, we do not know the exact arrangement of the box, or we do not know the exact layout by which the game will be coming up with these boxes. So each and every component, that is the green box, red box or the blue box, is getting generated randomly during the runtime. So this is the basic property or the requirement by which you will understand that you should go with the factory design pattern. So hopefully this makes some sense. So let's discuss further in depth with coding theory and example so that it will be much more easier for you to understand the complete factory design pattern. So let's first understand that what is a factory pattern. So a factory design pattern is one of the most used design pattern in Java. This type of design pattern comes under the creational pattern, as this pattern provides one of the best way of creating an object into our application. And whenever there is a possibility that several classes will try to follow the similar role or the pattern or the behavior of a particular class, at that time we follow the factory design pattern. Because over here in factory pattern, the class is chosen at the runtime. Means we can create an object without exposing the creation logic to the client. And the class object get automatically created by using a common interface which it is implementing. So this is the basic bookish knowledge of what is a factory pattern. So let's now understand that when we should use a factory pattern. So as you have seen that in our Atari breakout game, we have used the concept of factory pattern, because over here we do not know in advance that which color box will appear in which side of the layout, because the layout is getting generated dynamically at runtime. And also, if you have seen that over here we have discussed that each and every boxes, which is nothing but a class, have similar behavior or the nature, means that each and every class have some color code or some point or some breakout behavior that we are implementing on the class level. And that is the time when we have to think of the factory pattern. Because over here, using the factory pattern, we are also encapsulating the object creation for the user. So hopefully now it makes sense that what is a factory pattern and what is the real-time use case by which we will select a factory pattern. Now let's go into the UML design of the factory pattern. So over here you can see that for our Atari breakout game, over here we have an interface called a shape, which is nothing but a box. And over here within this interface, we have two abstract methods, and that is color and the point. There can be plenty more functions and attributes that can be associated with this class. But over here, I am taking these two as our example. Now, as you can see that we have three type of boxes, which is green, red and blue. And all these three type of boxes is basically implementing the parent class, that is shape. And by default, by the property of inheritance, all the three subclasses will have the properties of color and point. And based on the internal implementation of each and every box, we can override those property within this class. And over here, we have a separate class called the game driver, which is actually responsible for driving this entire game. And over here, on loading the game, this driver class is actually responsible for creating all the class objects, that is the glass block that we are creating over here. And on runtime, based on some condition, it will create multiple instances of the red, green and blue glasses object, which is actually implementing the shape interface. So this is the overall idea of the factory design pattern. So hopefully this makes some sense to you, and hopefully you have understand the design logic behind the factory design pattern. So let's go to the Java code for the implementation of the factories, because while the interviewer will ask you for the factory design pattern, he will definitely ask you to write the code for the same. Because without a proper example of the code, it doesn't make any sense that whether you have really understand the concept or not. So let's start with the implementation of a demo application which follows the factory design pattern. So let's start with the implementation. So for the demonstration of the factory pattern, let's first create a class over here called as factory pattern demo. And within this class, the first interface that I will be creating is the shape interface over here, which is basically the template of all the subclass which we will be implementing this interface. So let's create an interface over here called as shape. And for the demo purpose, within the shape interface, we will be creating two abstract class, one as gatePoint and one as gateColor. So this goes with our basic definition of the factory. So over here we have created an interface called as shape. Now we need to create the subclass which will be implementing this parent interface class. Let's create a subclass called as greenbox which will be implementing this shape interface. And since we are implementing this shape object, it's quite obvious by Java that we need to override the two function that is declared over here. So let's implement these two function within this green box and let's give a custom behavior to this class. So over here you can see I have overridden the abstract method that we have defined within this interface. Now let's create one more class called as redbox. So over here you can see that first we have created a shape class which is an interface, and we have created two class called as greenbox and the redbox, and we have implemented the shape class over there. Now let's create a game driver class from where we can randomly create different type of shape objects and we can create a prototype of the Atari Breakout game. So let's take example that this game driver is responsible for creating all the shapes that are associated within the game. Means that on runtime, based on some gaming logic, it will randomly create different objects of the green box and the red box dynamically during runtime. So let's create a method over here called as createGameObject. So over here, whatever the color of the box that we will be passing as a parameter, this driver class will be responsible for creating the instance of the red box and the green box dynamically during runtime. So hopefully this makes sense over here. So let's now write the main class over here which will internally call the game driver to run our prototype for the Atari Breakout game. So let's create the main method over here. And one more thing I would like to change over here is instead of making all this thing as the instance class, I will be creating all this class as a public one. So over here I will change the scope of this class. So right now our main class resides within this factory pattern demo. So let's implement a dummy logic over here which will drive our game driver from here. So let's first create an object of the game driver. And let's create a dummy logic over here which will create arbitrarily a red box and the green box during runtime. So over here our demo logic tells that over here we are iterating a loop from I equal to 0 to 50 and the random number which is generating, if it is an even number, that is the module of 2 equal to 0, then it will create a red block and it will display the point that is associated with the red block. Similarly, if it is not an even, it will create a green box and it will display the point associated with that. So let's run the program over here and let's see whether our demo for the factory setting is working fine or not. So great, over here you can see that the random block is getting generated dynamically and the point is getting also associated with it. So for the clear understanding of this output, let me add the block color also at the beginning. So over here you can see that our program is running successfully and it is exactly following the factory design pattern. So over here you can see that on the runtime we are creating different object called as red block or the green block dynamically during runtime, and also the blueprint of the class is encapsulated within this interface. So which is actually the two fundamentals that is necessary for designing a factory pattern. So hopefully you guys have thoroughly understand the video of how the factory pattern is internally working. And I do believe that with the help of few more examples, you can clearly explain it to the interviewer how a factory pattern works into an application. So hopefully this video was useful to you. And if you have found this video useful, please do like and share with your friends. And if you are new to my channel, don't forget to subscribe and hit the bell icon so that you never miss an update from my side and you are always ready for your next interview. So let's move to the next video of our design pattern series. See you on the next video. Thank you.